Shantae, Half-Genie Hero.
Next is a series I have never touched with Shantae, Half-Genie Hero Ultimate Edition. I've been very slightly aware of this series for about 10 years. I'd heard of the original game by colour game and I knew it got a sequel years later, but I didn't know it was up to 4 games already. Now why am I starting with the most recent game instead of the first like I'd prefer to with smaller series? 3 reasons. 2 in regards to not doing the first, that's this, and I don't have the means to record a 3DS, so its virtual console release is out. And third, as for why this one, because I already own this one for nearly a year. I bought the collector's edition for Switch on a whim once because it was £30 and just never got around to it. Being an Ultimate Edition, this version has all the DLC from the beginning. I wasn't expecting for there to be this many modes. This episode we're going to be doing Main Mode and Hero Mode. So, Shantae gets woken up in the middle of the night by a strange voice. We leave her bedroom and go out through the front door. Once we're outside her lighthouse house, we cross the bridge and go even further into the island. Keep on walking until we reach your uncle's workshop. He's asleep and there's a trapdoor open. Keep going further down into another area where the one enemy type keeps killing itself against the torches. At the end we find the voice, belonging to this ball of light. It calls itself a messenger from the genie realm. A messenger of the genie realm. And to summon Shantae to warn her of a great danger, an agent of darkness who will strike at the heart. Okay, I'll stop now. Of their world, intending to corrupt their magic and use it. Alright, now I'll stop. For themselves. Apparently being the daughter of the genies makes Shantae the only one who can stop it. She asks about her mother, but she starts to wake up before she can make out their answer. After that, we're introduced to our save point, some old guy. Next morning, Shantae's in Skull Town and tells me to go to her uncle. After I try out the buttons, I go into the workshop. Shantae tries to tell Mimic about her dream, but he needs her to get a part for one of his inventions from the shop. He sent Bolo to pick it up, but he hasn't come back yet. So I set off and make sure to chat to everyone along the way and get myself introduced to series regulars like Sky, who says Bolo went into the bathhouse. That's next door and Bolo's inside. He's too busy staring at the owner, so we talk to her. She'd normally give me advice how to continue the game, but she has a receipt for Mimic's part. How Bolo dropped it on the other side of the room, I have no idea. The item shop's just next to the bathhouse, I trade the sales slip for a magnet. I give it to Mimic and he shows off his newest invention, a dynamo. He's building it to generate enough electricity to light up the town at all times to keep monsters and pirates away, which will give Shantae a rest from protecting the town. He's still missing a few parts though, but then a Tinkerbat runs off of his blueprints. There's also the sounds of cannon fire coming from Main Street. Mimic tells me to get a ride from Sky's hatchery, so I go over there and she has her bird wrench transform into a giant. Sky then gives me a whistle before they climb on and fly off. This takes us to the level select screen, the only other choice is Main Street, so there I go. Wrench drops me off while Sky explains that the bird whistle is for calling Wrench to take me out of levels. And we begin the first level. There's this pirate ship in the back shooting giant cannonballs containing Tinkerbats. The only attack I have right now is whipping with Shantae's hair. Right now it does 5 damage, which is enough to kill Tinkerbats in one hit. Spacing myself from the enemies I take a little time to get used to, as every time they pop out I end up letting myself get hit. Luckily they only do 1 damage and I start the game with 8 health. There's also a few pots with hearts lying around anyway. Also some with gems inside, which is the game's currency. I run into Tinkerbats throwing petrol bombs and I just stand and see what would happen if one hit me. Next they start jumping out from boats, passing by the front and back of the screen. As a side note, the first time we were in this section of the level, instead of a normal level theme, it plays the game's main song, Dance Through Danger. I think it's fine. It's not really my preferred style of music, but I don't dislike it at all, like with the main songs of a few other games. It's a cool thing to do for the game's introduction. Some more cannon fire and Tinkerbats jumping from boss and we've reached the end of the first section. Between every section we get a chance to save. We're further in town now and it's engulfed in flames. There's now open fires just moving around on their own. I climb up the chain and the bricks that alternate popping out of the wall. Find an NPC I can't get to just yet. Also we now have Lil's actual theme playing that after very quickly checking out gameplay of the other games, I now know is a recurring theme. I get another tease with these vases on top of the building where I can't reach. I go around the stairs and through this building and climb more of those bricks. One more tease in the form of this flower I can't do anything with yet, and that's the end of this part. The pirate ship gets up close with Risky Boots in charge. This is the first time playing these games, but I did at least know of her. I'd heard the name before and I'd unlocked her spirit in Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, but that's about it. She has the blueprint, and to get it back we have to fight her part omni-organic, partially titanic, ocean-optional Tinker Slug, or Poop Toot. So, see that shiny bell? I missed it and got myself killed trying to figure out how to damage the Thinker Slug. Would you expect any less from me at this point? Believe me, that's nothing compared to what you'll see in a little while. Even better, on my second try, I saw it immediately. It brings an explosive barrel over that I can climb up to unlock it into the ship. This stuns the Tinker Slug and I can get a few hits on its face. Gotta wait for the crane to turn all the way back before I can get another barrel. So I keep repeating and on the fourth time, I defeat it. The whole thing explodes many times and Risky's forced to hand over the dynamo blueprints. She escapes on the other ship and Shantae comments on how she beat her right away for a change. So I assume she tends to be the final boss in the other games. This little platform appears to end the level with. We get warped to the genie realm where I open this chest to obtain the monkey dance. The X button makes Shantae a dance and gives me a choice between my transformations. With the monkey, I can run up walls and leave this place. Back in Mimic's workshop, and after Shantae is done recapping the level to him, the mayor of Skulltown walks in and fires her. Again, apparently. Main Street is a mess and pirates are still running around, so he's off to look for a new Guardian Genie. Once he's gone, Mimic gets back to work on the dynamo and tells Shantae to see if anyone in town needs help. I got 143 gems in that last level, so I see what I can get from the item shop. I get the Fireball spell and the Storm Puff spell. I check out the art gallery, but the mayor lost all 10 gallery keys around the world. Outside, I find a panicking girl screaming that all the young women from her village have disappeared. If we agree to help, she gives me the Mermaid Falls map. Before I can take off at Skies, the mayor interrupts with Shantae's replacement, Holly Lingerbean, another half-genie. Her reasoning for being more magical than another half-genie is being that her dad was also a stage magician. Shantae is pissed, but we have a new level to go to first. With the map, Mermaid Falls is now an option. After we land, it turns out Bolo came along at Mimic's request. Shantae believes that the kidnappings were done by mermaids out of jealousy. When Bolo thinks that he could be next and Shantae corrects him, he flips his shit and storms off to do everything himself. I start the level and accidentally use a Storm Puff. We have crabs and mermaids as our enemies here. Mermaids can be a pain the first time through since they shoot off 5 bubbles in all directions and they're quick. On a side note, I'd say that this section and the next have 2 of my favourite music tracks in the game. In the bottom right corner of the second screen, I see a chest I can't get to yet, cruelly teasing me. Now it's time to start climbing up and navigating the moving platforms. I get up to the upper levels of this area, and once I've been smashing up everything I can find for gems, I go to the top right corner where I find some of the girls in cages and into this cave. In the second area, we can see the women being carried off on these rings, where they're carried here to have a fish jump up and latch their mouths around the women's waist. I ride an empty ring over to the second screen where I accidentally use Storm Puff again while we see Bolo being carried off. I get to the other side where there's a giant block I can't break, so it's time to start climbing. A lot of ring holding and monkey climbing later, not to mention struggling with these easy to avoid gators that keep my health low. I think this place is the only time I actually use Storm Puff intentionally, I just never wound up finding it that useful. As I get towards the top, I climb up this wall as a monkey and find a platform I can't get to. This game is like a Metroid game where you're meant to be returning to places constantly after getting new upgrades. Lucky for me, I like that kind of game. I get up to the top right corner and into the last screen of the section, where I get my ass kicked by 2 of these guys because I didn't think to just jump down into the area below when they ran at me. At the end, I run into this snake lady, Tuki. She has her own special set of dances I can buy from her. I just buy the warp dance, which allows me to warp right to the next section of a level when revisiting it. After that, I go down this slide. With the slide, I have to avoid the barrels and jump over gaps. I can also pick up oranges while I'm here. These will be very important in a bit for very shameful reasons. Thing is, due to only having 2 health, I die quite a lot here, usually getting hit by the barrels that come from behind. After a few goes, I get to the end with only 1 health left. Shantae lands at the bottom and a barrel breaks open in the red to reveal a dazed Bolo. Shantae figures out that the kidnappings were for turning the girls into counterfeit mermaids. She runs into the culprit, Techno Baron. After a little talk, he walks off and reveals why the mermaids are attacking people. He has their queen captured. So, the Giga Mermaid. We have to break open all 6 locks keeping her chained up. Thing is, she's also pissed right off and is just throwing out attacks while I'm trying to help. And right away, a laser kills me. This next attack is the worst though. I'm sure there is a way to reliably dodge these balls every time, but even in the extra playthroughs I didn't find one, and with 1 health, it's not a good time. I dodge it the first time, but some of these just chase you forever. The next attack is 1 giant ball that moves slowly. I don't know why I jumped into it. Eventually I do destroy all 6 locks and set her free. Still not done yet though, and now she's shooting lightning from the sky and slamming a series of platforms and rings to climb up to which we're on the edge with. I don't win this time. Anyone watching this who's played the game before knows a very simple problem here. I didn't have to keep fighting with just 1 bit of health. I picked up those oranges in the slide. If I just paused the game once during this part, I'd have seen them on the item menu and been able to heal myself. I'd like to say I figured this out during the fight and easily beat the boss. But no, I spent 20 minutes on just the second boss until I finally pulled off a no damage run. I've made fun of dumb mistakes and bad playing before, but this is probably the one I'm most ashamed of so far. At one point I was thinking, maybe this game has some pretty bad balance issues. No, I'm just a fucking idiot. Who can imagine how happy I was when I finally got that last hit in? Turns out Techno Baron was selling the counterfeit mermaid as monster food because he was running out of real mermaids to sell. Shantae just gives him a smack for it. With it sorted out, Shantae apologises to the mermaids for accusing them of the kidnappings and we can end the level. This time in the Genie Realm we get the crab dance, this lets me walk along the bottom of water. Back with Mimic and we return the old women home off screen. Shantae asks how the dynamo is coming along and Mimic says he still needs 4 components, the first being copper wiring. He can make some but he needs a copper ore to do so, so we're gonna look for some. New information, the chef on Main Street makes salted caramel, she's the NPC we couldn't get to. This other lady with the exclamation point above her head wants me to go help said chef out. There's this worried woman wanting a monster's egg. This new guy in the item shop wants something for his bird's stomach problems. With the money I picked up last level I buy the backdash, which I always forget to use, and the silky cream to increase the speed of my hair attacks. Also this child wants some salted caramel. Fine, I'll help the chef. I have to revisit previous areas now anyway. Back in Main Street I can use the crab dance to sink to the bottom of all these watery parts. In the first, I go through his pipe to find a chest with a heart holder, which adds an extra heart to my health. In the next, the pipe leads to a gate to the genie realm where I find the green stone. When equipped, it lets me whip green gems to turn them into magic points. I don't bother with it. The third is cruel and has a pipe I still can't get to. Back in the second area, and I can use the monkey dance to reach the chef. She can't renew her health permit unless I kill 30 pirates in her restaurant. I can also use the monkey dance to reach the top of this building where I find another gate to the genie realm. This one contains the monkey bullet, which lets me shoot off a wall in a straight line as the monkey. The restaurant was this building at the bottom of those stairs. I take out the Tinker Bats and the 30th drops the health permit. I give it back to the chef and she gives me some salted caramel. That's all I find here, so it's time to go back. I give the caramel to the kid and she gives me 1 year of pay, which turns out to be birdseed. I give that to the guy in the end shop, which makes his bird shit out a massive copper ore. While I'm in here, I buy the Pike Ball spell, the Attract for drawing in nearby gems, and the Shampoo, which increases the damage dealt by the hair attacks by 1. I give Mimic the copper ore and he adds the wiring he makes out of it to a dynamo. Then suddenly Mimic and Bolo lose all their memories mid-conversation. Mimic doesn't know who Shantae is and Bolo doesn't know his own name. Everyone in town is affected too. The big guy says the mayor wanted to see her but he can't remember why. The kid thinks Shantae is his mother. Sky doesn't know who she is but can still remember to fly his levels. There's no real problem here. Basically, only side quest NPCs and those with gameplay functions are unaffected. Mayor Scoreboy just aimlessly wandering around, all he can remember is that Holly had to go somewhere. He is holding a Tasseltown map though, which is where Shantae figures she went, so that's where we're going. Shantae wonders if this is even the right place since it's completely ruined. A voice says it was destroyed centuries ago, it turns out to be Holly. She refused to be of any help and throws out some insults before walking off. The level starts off simply enough, walking forward, beating up little cactus guys. Sometimes birds drop them on me while I'm dealing with another, that's a pain. This wall's too high so I have to sink down as the crab. Down here I find the first of 10 sunken souls. While I'm here, I've got to say I'm thankful for the game having catchy music on the desert level. So many games want to be more atmospheric with their desert levels, which just means dull music. A lot of games with great soundtracks tend to have my least favourite track be the desert music. Sandopolis Zone Act 2 in Sonic & Knuckles and Bicanale Island in Final Fantasy X for example. So this game avoiding that is much appreciated. When it comes to really good memorable desert music, the three I think of are this game, The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time and Sonic Lost World. Also, there's another of these big blocks underwater blocking me from exploring more. Once I'm out of the sandstorm start, they're strong enough to blow me back quite a bit when not behind some cover, like a block. It goes on for a little bit too long, I think. By the time I was done with this, it had worn out its welcome for me. There's also a genie realm gate that has a permanent sandstorm in the middle, just to tease you. Not long after that though, and I'm in the second section. We enter this building and this big lad shows up. This is the chase sequence, the giant worm slowly rises up and touching him is an instant death. But there's also loads of obstacles along the way, like these fire-breathing statues, these skeletons, and alternate paths that get me nowhere in the first visit and get me killed. There's block pushing and a lot of climbing as the monkey, but eventually I make it to the top and I can leave. Now for the part I struggled with the most. Let that set the tone for the next 25 minutes. When I wasn't missing the timing on my jumps, enemies were hitting me out of the sky or I could just not defeat some of these archers without taking one hit. The worst part was always this section here. Trying to make these jumps while avoiding the jumping guys while trying to hit these birds so they don't touch me while also trying to avoid the bombs they drop. And let's just leave it at that. This section isn't badly designed or really as hard as I made it look. Sometimes things just go badly for you, so let's just skip to my successful attempt. I get past this sequence of bricks and take out these archers while not going for this chest. More bricks and another archer and I'm onto the second screen. A series of moving and dropping platforms and I still got hit by one bomb. This leads to another chest I can't get yet. Spend way too long strategizing with these archers at the end and I'm into the third screen. Luckily, if I fall into a pit, it just respawns me at the beginning of the screen, not the area. After falling at the same block because I didn't want to wait three times in a row, I think, what about some patience? But instead, I just use the monkey's longer jumps to get across. Get fucked, patience. I see Tookie's vase, but I can't get to it. After panicking over a bird and these two archers, you can see the moment I discover I can eat the food I've been picking up to heal and realise I deserved all the difficulty I'd been having. Not that though. That was right before the end too. At least I'm done. I meet up with Holly on the roof, where she admits to being the cause of the lost memories. She's not a half-genie, she's a memory. Basically, she was Tasseltown's biggest celebrity, got all the awards, was loved by everyone, then a sandstorm that lasted hundreds of years came and wiped them all out. She only survives because she found Wilbur, the giant sandworm that was chasing us. He feeds on neurotransmissions, so she just has him eat the memories of everyone else so the memory of her is strongest and she can continue to exist. She feeds Skulltown's memories to him and then has him fight us. Wilbur's the first boss I wasn't incompetent with, so I beat him on my first try. He fires a load of rocks from his mouth, they all smash an impact except for one glowing one. I smack it into a cannon, then press the button to shoot it into his eye. This knocks it out and makes it roll along the roof where I have to whack it a few times. After that I start shooting copies of his eye at us before the pattern repeats. Keep it up a few more times and he's done. This releases all the memories he'd eaten and with her no longer being the dominant memory, she fades away. That's the end of that level. This time the genie wheel gives us the elephant dance, which allows me to break through big cracked blocks. Back in Skulltown, everyone has their memories back. Sky and Bolo decide to make sure everyone in town is alright, while Mick lets us know what he needs next. He needs opposing shards of light and dark magic. Shantae doesn't want to be messing with dark magic, but as long as the two are balanced, it should be fine. First, she decides to go looking for a dark shard. I picked up a monster egg from one of the birds I killed and give it to the Amazon for another heart holder. In the item shop, I buy some bikini armor to reduce damage I take by half, and the metronome to double the speed of my dancers so I can cycle through them quicker. I run into Rottytops, who is the only other character I was slightly aware of before, as in, I'd heard the name once. She wants to see the race with her brothers at Cape Crustacean, but they have no money. She wants two tickets, in return she'll give me something nice. I also run into these two, Twitch and Vinegar. I guess they must be recurring characters too. Even though they work for the Ammo Baron, they're not here for a fight. They want two gear stakes. In exchange, they'll give us a race ticket. Time to go back to Mermaid Falls. It's night time here now. First thing I do is use the Crab Dance to get my second sunken soul seconds from the start. Also, now the mermaids aren't mad at us anymore, they've been switched out for naggers. In the second screen, I have a lot of water to explore, but they're still holding things back from me. In fact, I can't get anything down there just yet. I enter this gear and push the block into the hole with the elephant. This gets me the mermaid dance, which can swim freely in water. Now I can actually get stuff underwater. I get to that chest that teased me earlier for the first gallery key. Still can't get everywhere underwater though, because I can't break these blocks yet. I can get a first sunken soul while I'm down there though. Up top, I discover yet another little bit I can't get to before moving on to the second section. Here I can use the crab to find the first and second of five blobfish kids along with the sunken soul number four. But there are still these little blocks keeping me from other items. On the second screen, everything is blocked off underwater, but I can use the elephant to smash through this corner where I find the grandma blobfish. Her grandkids have run off, and to help get them back she gives me the crab claw, which finally gives the crab dance an attack. It also lets me cut through the grassy blocks so I can get blobfish kid 3, sunken soul 5, and the last two blobfish kids. I take them back to their grandmother and she gives me a race ticket. I then use the warp dance to leave, completely forgetting about those gear stakes. Thing is, I should have used the whistle, since warps gets me to the next area, so now I have to play the slide again. I realise my mistake and go back in. I fireball the gates of death and get their stakes. I also remember to try exploring the upper areas. With the monkey bullet I can get to this gate in the top left corner. Here I get the bat dance. The bat can only fly in a straight horizontal line. There are places where it's needed, but I wasn't too fond of this one. While I'm here, I visit Tuki again and buy the revive dance, which uses up my magic to restore health, and the dryad dance, which uses magic to harvest fruit. This time I actually remember to use the whistle to leave. I give Twitch and Vinegar their gear to stakes and get the second race ticket. I give them to Rotti and she gives me a dark shard. She asks Shantae to come to the races with her, but we're busy. I then stop by the item shop and buy the bubble spell. I give Mimic the shard and he puts it in place. Then some guy just walks in and says there's going to be a heist to the big race. Mimic tells us to go because at an event that big, hundreds of people could be harmed. He also gives me the Cape Crustacean map. Off we go then. So Bolo and Rotti are there too, and I guess Sky doesn't like Rotti for reasons I might understand if I had played an earlier game. It seems the heist plan involves stealing a lot of magic carpets. Shantae is going to pose under cover as a pilot to figure out what's going on. Bolo and Sky will watch in the stands and Rotti will pose as a pit girl. So the race starts and we jump on our carpet. This isn't so much a race as it is an auto-scroller. Gotta make my way across the carpets and other vehicles. Not required to beat a Peridron, but why not at this point? Falling just causes a little bit of damage and bounces you back up, mercifully. We get to the end and meet back up with Twitch and Vinegar, revealing themselves to be the thieves. I have a trio of rotating carpets and they fly in circles so I can just stay in the front and keep swinging. They'll also take turns shooting at me. I use the bubble to shield myself from damage as they combine vehicles for a big laser. A little later I take them both down. Shantae then starts looking for where they've taken the carpets. This level secondary has Shantae landing this airship. There's big guys with bayonets running at me and I walk right over these flaps the enemies are popping out of that I can drop down myself. I forgot about this and now I'm screaming at myself to realise my mistake. Next comes dodging these lasers and beating up cannons. After that they start dropping an almost endless chain of soldiers for me to beat up. On the next ship I go under and find a door. Inside is a laser travelling along the room with one platform blocking it. I use the monkey to get up to it and find the second gallery key. Continuing across some more I get a row of four alternating lasers and pass them another door. Here's seven lasers that stay off for a very short amount of time. No time to run across, and the elephant just can't make it. A couple minutes and I still won't let myself be beat. I use a dryad dance, which can't be damaged by the lasers, and slowly inch my way across. This gets me another heart holder. Not long after is yet another door, but this one just has enemies and vases in it. Disappointing. After that is a hatch leading to the next section. Now we're inside the airship. Smash through into the next room with the elephant and take on more of these guys. Then drop down and explore before I even realise what happened. This time I take it carefully for once, and move on to another screen filled with lasers and spikes. I drop down here to find another of those flowers, and the secret area, but I can't get anything in there yet, sadly. I navigate the lasers and chains, and the saw, and smash through to the fourth screen. More soldiers, and I drop down and go through this hole to find another gate. Everything's dark and it's loaded up with spikes, so I leave it for now. Next screen has a lot of chains to climb, guys throwing dynamite and big blocks to knock around. These blocks help me find a secret area to test my use of the monkey bullet. It's easy enough, you just have to remember that you're always slipping down the walls you cling to slowly. At the end is my fourth heart holder. Climb up to the real exit for this room, which leads me outside to the ship's engine, which I proceed to beat to death. Among the wreckage is Ammo Baron. Shantae accuses him of trying to cheat to win the race. He's not interested in the race though, he wants the magic silk from the carpets to make magic carpet uniforms for his soldiers so that they can fly freely. They deploy their MCUs and start a fight. Ammo Baron makes himself a shield out of his flying soldiers and will occasionally send one to dive bomb me. It will also have them spin around him, but as they fly away from him, that gives me the chance to strike. After that, a crosshair appears on the floor and they all try barging through me. This is easy to deal with, depending on where they end up aiming. After that, Ammo Baron surrounds himself with more rows of soldiers. Thanks to my 6 hearts and bikini armor, I can ignore most of them and keep hitting Ammo Baron. It's after he shields himself with 3 rows of guys that I finish him off. Their uniforms will explode and they fall to the ground. Twitch and Vinegar take Ammo Baron off in a stretcher, but no one helps the generics. Shantae is announced the winner of the race due to being the only one left standing. I finish the level and my reward this time is the mouse dance. It allows Shantae to crawl through what looked to be just decoration before, but are actually little tunnels. Back at Mimics, and it turns out the first prize was a lifetime supply of Mermaid Falls monster food. Shantae isn't interested and Rotty says she'll take it, saying that they have to enjoy life while they still can. The dynamo is coming along nicely, so now it's time to look for that light shard. There's a travelling doctor in the bathhouse who isn't any use to us just yet. In the item shop, I buy the super shampoo, which has another point of damage to my hair attacks. A big guy tells me a hermit in the desert tower might help me get that light shard, and I open the 2 art gallery doors that I can. Now it's time to revisit the previous levels again. With a mermaid dance, I can get to that pipe in Main Street's first area that I couldn't last time. Inside, I meet Adventure Man, who rambles on and gives me a Vorpal blade he stole from an Azure Knight. Watching myself pass this with the monkey twice now is pissing me off at myself. Next, I go back to Tasseltown. The sandstorms are gone, so this place is a lot easier to explore. The sandstorm in the genie realm is still there, but with the elephant I can walk right through it. This gets me the spider dance. It allows me to shoot a web straight upwards and walk along the ceiling. Back inside the tower I meet this hermit. He claims to be a genealogy guy who's looking for remains. He says they're under those flowers I've been passing the whole game and gives me the elephant stomp, so I can unearth them. All sets of remains are in this tower, and with Wilbur gone, I can explore it at my own pace. The dragon head that shot fireballs at me last time can be destroyed with the elephant's charge attack. Most of them lead to a secret area, the first one giving me my first set of remains. The charge can also travel through the air, so I can break this dragon head and get the second set. Further up I find a tunnel to travel through as the mouse so I can open this chest with my third gallery key. At the top of all those chains I find another secret area with more remains. Even further up is a block I can push in to get a chest with gallery key number 4. Smashing more dragon heads to the 4th and 5th sets of remains. I get walked back to the hermit and he thanks me by sneezing on me so I get sick. Well, the game sent me back to the beginning before I was done checking out everything, so I get to climbing back up. The next dragon head I break leads to a maze for the mouse to get through, leading to another heart holder. A little further up is another tunnel for the mouse, leading to the genie realm where I get the mouse bite attack. Now I'm back at the top and there were these platforms in the middle of 2 spiked walls I couldn't do anything with, but now I can use the spider dance to get up there and get my 6th heart holder. Revisiting the third area, and I really like how they changed the background of most of the levels for a revisit. Usually it's just a different time of day, but it's appreciated. I use the bat to glide over to this chest with the 5th gallery key inside, and later on I can use the spider to get to this chest with yet another heart holder inside. I can also reach Tuki now, and I buy the obliterate dance from her. That's everything I got from this place. Back in town I see the doctor and give him my sick. He cures me and gives me a lollipop. In the item shop I buy the mega shampoo to fully upgrade my hair damage. I then crush this flower by the save guy for the first of 5 scrap metal. Then it's returning to Mermaid Falls. Right away I find another piece of scrap metal under a flower. I start navigating the tunnels as the mouse on the second screen, including using the moving platforms. A lot of platform navigating later and I pop out in front of this wizard. He really wants sweets, so I give him the lollipop. In return he gives me a light shard. With that I return to Mimic and give it to him. Now there's only one piece missing. Rotty says she has to leave, repeating her line about enjoying life while they still can. Turns out it isn't a joke based on her being a zombie, but the end of the world is apparently coming. Some guy called Hypno Baron is summoning a creature of unspeakable horror. She wants to head off to Hypno Baron's castle, so she gives me the map to get there. I take the map to Sky and set off there. Shantae catches up to Rotty Tops despite Rotty having walked there and us taking the bird. Turns out Hypno Baron learned how to summon the creature from Rotty's brothers in exchange for a bag of coffee. Inside the castle we have a slightly more limited view, chandeliers falling on me, and skeletons. I enter the first doorway and it takes me to another corner of the screen. That's this level's thing, it's kind of a maze. Until you enter you have no idea where that doorway is going to take you. This could have turned out annoying, but I wound up enjoying it. It's easy enough to memorize. I try to get up the top of the roof, but I can't yet, so I drop down and have the chest I find turn out to be haunted. Then I end up accidentally picking the exact combination of doorways to get to the next area. I wanted to find things! We're outside again and have a new obstacle to deal with. These blocks with an eyeball that keep looking in different directions. When you get on top of them, they start moving in the direction they're looking. No try to cheat with the bat. They thought of it. It can work sometimes though. That's pretty much how this section goes. Never gets my blocks beat up spider women. After the first couple, getting the timing down on these blocks is easy enough. If you do mess up, you can just turn into the bat and hover in place until the block comes back. Also, I don't like it when flowers just have gems under them. I was excited for a new item. One last set of blocks, and I enter this building. Here I run into Hypno Baron. It's too late though and the summoning has started. The creature of unspeakable horror emerges and turns out to be Squid Baron. He's thrilled about being the fifth boss this time. I really wish I'd played the other games now because I feel like I'm missing out. He thinks he'll be starring in his own game soon, but Shantae doesn't think it's a lucrative idea. He's furious at Shantae's lack of belief and starts a fight. He spins side to side across the screen and then up above us to shoot pink laser stuff down. Once he lands, he starts trying to crush us, but he's easily dealt with. He explodes a lot and look at that face. I feel bad now. He's not dead though, and Hypno Baron joins in on the fight. He levitates Squid Baron and tries dropping him on me. Their other form of attack is Hypno Baron throwing a fireball at me while Squid Baron jumps to the other side of the screen and creates a shockwave along the floor. I don't put much effort into trying to dodge them since I have so much food stocked up. I do more damage and Squid Baron starts creating two shockwaves along the floor while Hypno Baron throws multiple smaller fireballs. Squid Baron goes down first and a little bit later I finish off Hypno Baron. Shantae feels awful because she thinks she's actually killed Squid Baron while Hypno Baron says he only summoned him to option his merchandising rights. Turns out there was no world ending going on. Hypno Baron leaves and we finish the level. This time we get the Harpy Dance, which allows me to fly freely. I like this one a lot. Once again, we're back at Mimic's workshop. Mimic congratulates Shantae on defeating evil 5 times in one day, but now it's time to get that final part for the dynamo. Apparently, hand cranks don't exist anymore, so Mimic improvises and settles on needing a hamster wheel. Rotty suggests a zombie hamster so it'll never get tired. Her brother Poe has a zombie hamster and will also need an iron slab, but we'll have to ask around town for that. The guy outside the item shop hints at it being in Tasseltown, but it's clear I don't have the relic for it yet. Inside is the Azure Knight, the guy Adventureman took the Vorpal Blade from. I give it him back and he gives me the Regal Headwear, a foxy grandma hat. Since I'm in here, I also buy these Super Silica Cream to speed up my hair attacks even more, and these Super Attract to pull in gems from even further away. Grandma Blobfish is outside the art gallery and is self-conscious about her hat being old-fashioned, so we give her the foxy grandma hat to make her look more hip. As thanks, she gives me the Mermaid Bubble. This is what I needed to get the Iron Slab. Time to go back to Hypno Baron's castle already. After trying out one of the doorways I missed last time, I find my 8th hat holder. I also run into Abner, one of Roddy Top's brothers. He wants a poster since him and Poe are planning on taking this place over and he wants to spruce it up a bit. I can finally get on the roof now thanks to the Happy Dance and I find another gate to the Genie Realm. Inside I find the Bat Sonar Relic. On the other side of the roof I can drop down to find Poe. His hamster doesn't seem to like the castle as much as he does and he wants to give it a good home, so we take him off his hands. Next up I revisit Cape Crustacean. Guess who forgets to use Warp Dance and replays the race despite there being nothing else to do there. This time I actually noticed the first door and jumped down to go in. I wouldn't be able to get anything the first time anyway since I need the Elephant Stomp to get down to this chest with another gallery key inside. That's all I had left to get in this area, so back inside the airship I go. In the second room I can use the Harpy to get up through this spike gap. It takes me to a room with a red stone. This one turns red gems into hearts when I whip them. I also don't use this one. I smash that flower I found with my third piece of scrap metal, but I still can't do anything in the flooded room. I go back into the dark room with the bat sonar I can see where I'm going and eventually navigate all these spikes to find a spider venom relic. Not that useful since I don't use the spiders for fighting. That's all to find here for now. Back to Mermaid Falls and spend way too long trying to get here before giving up and going back to Tasseltown. I use the Elephant Stomp to break this block and then sink down into the crab to find a 6th sunken soul and a pipe leading to a series of dragon heads followed by another pipe that takes me to a chest with yet another heart holder. After that I leave. I miss something very obvious in here. I return to Main Street and in the second area I use the Harpy to fly up to the upper left corner where I find the waterfall relic. This is going to be useful. It lets me swim at waterfalls as a mermaid. Back to Mermaid Falls again, and I swim up a waterfall to find another gate with the Harpy Talon inside. Now I can fight as the Harpy. Using the Mermaid Bubble, I can blast away this block and go through this pipe and swim up this waterfall to find my 10th heart holder. While I'm down there, I can also use the Mermaid Bubble to get another sunken soul and one more with the Crab Claw, bringing me up to 8 of them. After too much pissing around, I figure out the obvious method to get to this little area. Go through a really long tunnel sequence as a mouse and get another gallery key. That's not all though, I can go even further to find another chest containing one more heart holder. I return to the factory area where I find the 4th piece of scrap metal under another flower. Thanks to the Harpy Dance, I can save a lot of travel time in this section. Up at the top I find a hidden door between these two torches. It leads to a shitload of spikes. In my infinite wisdom, I think maybe the Harpy is the key to get through this. No, it's a combination of the spider and bat. At the end of this is a chest with a data chip inside. Finally, I smash through another cracked block and get another gallery key. That leaves me with all collectibles except for one sunken soul from here. I return to Tasseltown and remember I can smash through this block now. I find the 9th sunken soul and a pipe leading to the iron slab. Rather than give it and the hamster wheel to Mimic, I go back to Main Street and walk past it again, but I do remember to stomp that first flower I found for the last piece of scrap metal. Back in town and I buy the triple fireball, super pike ball, mirror, max attract, magic bracelet, mega silky cream and mega puff. I give Mimic the zombie hamster and iron slab. This allows him to make the hamster wheel and complete the dynamo. Sky shows up to check it out and after it starts up, it starts smoking. It starts zapping Shantae and Risky Boots drops in. She'd swapped the blueprints at the beginning of the game and we've been building the dynamo to her design. It's taking negative energy generated by the dynamo and converting it into dark magic and pumping it all into Shantae, inverting her magic. She states her intent to modify the dynamo further to create the dark magic on a larger scale, like, say, corrupting the entire genie realm. The dynamo gets taken and Risky leaves the residue with Shantae. Shantae is all evil now for a bit and she has an argument with herself in her head before Sky, Rotty Tops and Bolo give all that pep talk stuff. You know, we're friends, and you're not a dick, I suppose. And they undo it. I don't care for this little bit, kinda boring, which is why I've rushed past it. Turns out Risky left the map to her hideout on the floor. We can go straight to her now, but others think we should wait. Mimi thinks if we find some clues as to how Risky plans to modify it, he could create a device to counter the dynamo's dark magic. Of course I'm going for 100%, so I want those clues. Techno Baron's outside the workshop, having been sentenced to a billion hours of community service, but he refuses to work until he gets his data chip back. So I give it to him and he gives me Risky's cufflink. Hypno Baron's in the bathhouse wanting the sunken souls, but I'm still missing one. Ammo Baron's outside the item shop wanting the scrap metal to fix his ship. I give it to him and get Risky's pendant. Squid Baron is in the art gallery, not dead. He gives me a velvet poster of some fan art of him. Time to pass through the odd levels again. Risky's hideout shows up on the level select, but I'm not going there yet. In Main Street one last time, and I finally go into this gap I've been able to check out almost the entire game now. Inside I get the final hat holder. In the factory in Mermaid Falls, I use the mermaid bubble to get the last sunken soul. I go up to Tuki and trade my warp dance for the gem jug dance. This allows me to create gems at the cost of magic power. But I just sit in the bathhouse and keep refilling my magic while watching that gem counter go up. Once I get 300 gems, I buy the invincibility spell. I then remember to give Hypno Baron some consoles for Risky's Ribbon. I keep creating more gems and buy the Flamethrower, Scimitar and Super Mega Puff spells. That's everything bought from the item shop, but I still need a little more. After making myself 500 more gems, I return to Sasseltown, and remember, I traded the warp dance so I can't just skip ahead. I push a block up to this dragon head in the tower and smash through to find a puzzle. I've got to use the elephant to push the blocks with these tunnels down in the right order so I can use the mouse to get to the chest with the 9th gallery key. In the third area, I buy the Super Revive Dance from Tuki and trade between the remaining dances I never had yet, as owning them at least once counts towards a percentage. I end up owning the Tinkerbat, Blobfish and Sophia the Third dancers. I do recognise Sophia the Third as being from the Blaster Master games, but I've never played them. Also, guess who didn't think to get their warp dance back now they have no need for gems? Well, that's everything in the first three levels collected, now for that last gallery key in Cape Crustacean. 5 minutes I could have skipped with some common sense later, and I'm in that flooded room. I navigate the waterfalls as the mermaid and get the final gallery key. That just leaves giving Abner the poster in exchange for a squid poster. I go back to the item shop to buy a mega potion because I'd never had one and wasn't sure if the consumable healing items count towards the 100%. To be honest, I'm still not sure. I give Squid Baron the squid poster and he loves it so much he gives me Risky's buckle. After that I open up all the gallery doors and talk to Mescal but for the magical tiara, which refills magic. On normal mode this basically means infinite magic because it refills so quick. For the final item, I give Mimic all of the clues Risky left behind. Based on markings and other things left on them like ash or oil, he knows to create the magical polarizer. With it, Shantae can cancel the inversion process on the dark magic. This item is required to get the good ending. There's only one thing left now.
It's time to stop Risky Boots once and for all!
I finally travel to Risky's hideout. When we land, the genie voice tells us to destroy them if they get completely corrupted, otherwise the entire world is screwed. We're not inside yet, we have to get in underwater. I go through the pipe and enter a sort of side-scrolling shooter section. The starfish in the mist can end up as backup and when you have three, you're basically unstoppable. Once I get those three, nothing changes until I make it to the end. Now we're inside a volcano. It starts off simple enough, just pounding the platform down with the elephant and crossing a couple gaps as the bat. There's even a section that feels clearly for the monkey, but I can cheat it with the harpy. Now that's just the first screen. Now we have a series of spiked floors and walls to navigate. A few more enemies later, and we're onto area 3. This one isn't as forgiving. Cross a large gap as the bat with spiked balls rising and dropping, only to realise you can't use the bat as you can't fly over the last one. You have to use the harpy, which is a lot more difficult. Then you've got to cross a similar area, but the spikes take up even more room. Use the monkey bullet on gaps that are just big enough for you to barely make it, and then flying past spike blocks that move in more than one direction before finishing off this part. We're at the end now. Given one more chance to save and to heal before catching up to Risky. She claims that it's impossible to reverse the dark magic and that the Tinkerbats are still working on the dynamo before starting the fight. She has various guns and can dash across the screen with her scimitar. Also, I use a super mega puff spell. I completely forgot I even used it once. She could bounce along the screen firing giant cannonballs from her blunderbuss and crash down on top of us with a giant anchor and throwing down bombs while Tinkerbats try to swarm me. I even used the invincibility spell, I don't remember any of this. But then I discover Scimitar, which is the best one, don't even try to argue. It's a Scimitar that gets the last hit in on Risky. But Risky says we're too late and we're taken up to Risky's version of the Dynamo. Why does he die? So, we've got to destroy the Tinker Brain. He has cogs bounce at us while we have to run in one direction to light up one of the screws in its head. When a screw fully lights up, these pop out and I have to hit them until they're fully lit up too. The scimitar continues to be the best. Then it tries a massive heat ray, but it's too slow for me. It seems the first time I accidentally discovered how to damage this guy because I don't know what the fuck I'm doing here. I recorded this 5 or 6 months ago and so I never remember every detail, but watching it now, I am getting pissed off at this player acting like a cockend. Oh, you finally figured it out. What's the matter? Did too well on the level leading up to this, you thought you'd make up for it with some utter idiocy. Once all 5 are lit up, one of the screws explodes out of it. It tries to make up for that with 3 cogs instead of 1, but it's not a problem. The other screw goes and it starts exploding. Shantae celebrates for the activation of the dynamo, but then she hears the voice. We get transferred into the genie realm and they're all grateful. But they've already been corrupted. Risky shows up and demands they submit, and the Tinker Brain reactivates, giving all the genies the same corrupted colour scheme Shantae had. Risk has a chuckle and jumps on screen while Shantae accepts she has to destroy the genie realm. The Tinker Brain now has a shield surrounding it with a small gap. To damage it, I have to destroy one of the genies and hit its magic into the Tinker Brain's core when the gap in its shield passes by. The first few hits are easy, but as it speeds up, it becomes easy to mess up the timing. The scimitar continues to be the best as it takes out the genies really quick. A few hits later and the Tinker Brain properly explodes this time. Risk is pissed but leaves as the volcano starts erupting. Also, we save a zombie hamster. Now we have one last slide to deal with. We have infinite health so we don't have to worry about dying, but falling into the gaps does make you start from the beginning. A lot of cog dodging and ring grabbing while the lava flow keeps getting closer. Eventually it cuts to the map screen as the hideout starts exploding and Shantae is saved by Sky and Wrench. We cut to them outside Shantae's lighthouse house. Burlo and Rotty Tops also show up to congratulate us. The mayor comes grovelling asking for Shantae to take her job back. Mimic shows up, Shantae thanks everyone, Burlo congratulates himself and walks off. Rotty decides to go help her brothers renovate the castle and travel with her zombie caravan again. Also, the hamster's name is Dookie. Sky leaves to feed Wrench. Shantae apologises to Mimic about the dynamo and fills him in on what happened. The voice interrupts and it turns out the genie realm was purified after all. Shantae asks about her mother and the voice says she's fine and she spent the last few years working towards the safety of Shantae's world. This is the good ending. If you didn't get the 4 clues and the polarizer, the genie realm would be destroyed. So, is the voice we've been talking with all game Shantae's mother or not? Because sometimes it seems like it. Shantae takes Mimic off to celebrate and the light rises into the sky before the credits play. This is a pretty good first impression for the series. I wish I played this sooner considering how long I had it and I'm certainly interested in trying out the other games. Final time a little under 6 hours and 100% completion. I unlocked 2 bonus gallery pictures, one for beating the game 100% and another for just beating the game. I'm still missing 2 though, fastest time and 100% fastest time. This is where hero mode comes in, this time I'll use Shantae's blue colour scheme. So what's different in hero mode? Well, we start with all the mandatory dancers from the beginning, the monkey, crab, elephant, mouse and harpy. This means I can get a lot of collectibles much earlier than I'm supposed to, and since I start this up immediately after finishing normal mode, I remember where everything is. For example, it means I can have double the normal health for the Tinker Slug fight. Once again though, it's just the dancers you get from finishing levels, you also don't start with their attack relics either. I can get the Crab Claw on the first visit to Mermaid Fall since I have the elephant and cut out a lot of mandatory backtracking. And do the complex platforming at the factory? Nah, I just happened my way up there. Also redeem myself against the Giga Mermaid. This part was just very cathartic. Also, who cares about your carefully constructed platforming and timing challenge? Story and level layout are exactly the same. I collect everything except a lot of the stuff I need to buy and finish with 82% at 2 hours 21 minutes, unlocking me the fastest time picture. The game uses the Metroid method of quicker time equals less clothes. Then I spent a good while gem jugging all the money I need to buy the rest of the items. This gets me a... What? I forgot to do one of Tuki's trades. So I beat the game again, for a final time of 2 minutes under 3 hours, at 100%, getting me the last picture. Whatever pictures you get in normal, hero or hard mode will apply for all 3 of them. All of the modes will have their own 4 pictures too, but we'll see that next time. You won't be seeing hard mode next time because my idiot self accidentally deleted it trying to move the footage. I lost a few of the things too, but they were re-recorded. Hard mode just didn't have anything interesting enough to justify the 4 hours redoing it, so sorry about that. It would have been another quick skim over like hero mode anyway. But look forward to next episode where I'll be doing all the DLC modes.